What happened to the people during the Depression? Why didn't, I mean, they just went along with the program. I mean, they were just as brainwashed and as the people of today, and people today are even more brainwashed than those of the of 29 and 30 and during the Depression. I mean, didn't, why weren't people outraged then?
It's simple. No communication. You got it. You're doing it. They didn't have it. I mean, radio was a relatively new thing.
Or maybe they were just so hungry they didn't have a choice.
No, I think there was no communication. The educational system, well, it was good, you know, for those who went to school. Many people didn't. They worked in factories and on farms and starting around 8 or 9 or 10 or 11, 12 years old. So they never had any what we would call formal education. There was higher illiteracy in America than there is today. And so... You know, that's part of the shortfall. But it's really communication. They don't know. People in America today who don't know don't wish to know.
Yeah, but the people in the cities knew. They had newspapers.
Well, they don't talk about what you and I talk about on this program, do they?
I know.
I mean, how many times do you see me run links to articles to the Washington Post, the New York Times, the L.A. Times, the Boston Globe, et cetera?
Yeah.
Incidentally, the Inquirer, Examiner, wait a minute, San Francisco Chronicle is talking about going out of business, one of the Hearst newspapers, big anchor for them. And they're complaining that people aren't subscribing. And I got a piece by a blogger that's going in Saturday's issue. We just picked it up today. And essentially what it says is, you wouldn't be going out of business if you told people the truth. And he lists a whole bunch of things. You know, like, why don't you tell people the truth about the bombing of Pearl Harbor or 9/11? And he went on and on. And if you do that, you'll stay in business because people will buy your newspaper because they know they're getting the truth.
Yeah.
And so almost all the newspapers in America will go down. And that's that. And then the news services will go down. And the only form of communication will be shortwave and the Internet and some radio stations. That's where we're headed with all this. And, of course, they want to take the Internet away from us. Now, that's not going to happen. You get the same reaction to that as you will eventually with unemployment and starvation and everything else will cause problems like revolution.
People are addicted to the Internet.
There's not a person I talk to who hasn't bought weapons, and most of them lately, and coins, and food. It's amazing. I mean, the people who do listen are doing it. And it's the smartest thing they can do. It's life insurance, really. And I think that there's a very powerful message going out that there's something exceedingly wrong when bankers and Wall Street financiers are allowed deliberately to destroy our system so that they can implement world government. And people don't even understand what world government is. But if you explain it to them simply, they'll say, oh, gee, I never thought of that. And now how many states do we have who have proposed or passed legislation to get their sovereignty back? I got a piece coming out in Saturday on that as well. And I got some in this issue today. I am astounded, really astounded, that the states have taken these actions. I would have never thought they would, but they are. The Tenth Amendment says, in essence, all powers not delegated to the federal government are hereby given to the states. And the federal government has trampled on the rights of the states long enough. And what really got this going was the specter of gun control. And what they're going to tell the government is this, all the ones who pass this, and they'll probably all pass it, we are not going to follow your dictates on gun control. It belongs to the states. And if you try to do that, we'll secede. That's interesting. And it could very well happen. And that would be very just joining, but would take the power away from the federal government. And if the states got together and said, hey, look, let's tell the federal government to do this, and if they don't, we won't even cooperate with them. We won't even talk to them. There's big things coming. And this sovereignty issue of the Tenth Amendment is one of the most powerful things I've ever seen in my 50 years of doing what I'm doing. It's very, very positive. And I'm just amazed it's being done, and I'm happy it's being done. Because those nutcases in Washington and New York City, they want to subject us. They want to get people, the bubbas, to go out and start shooting at the police. That's what they want. And the flag goes up, and Homeland Security says, martial law. That's what they're looking for. Don't give them the excuse. Don't shoot unless shot at. Even if you have to take a round. You don't want to instigate everything, because that's what they want you to do. You only move when you have to. I only have one question today. And that is, can you expand upon the Goldman Sachs manipulation of the comics in detail? And the answer to that, and there's more, no, I can't. Because I can't get into what the insiders are doing. We don't know. We're only guessing what they're doing. Because they're not going to tell us. The CFTC is not going to tell us. The SEC is not going to tell us. Our federal government, no branch is going to tell us. I mean, if you can just look at just what went on, Dennis Kucinich, which his comments on this are in this issue. It's another videotape link that's in the U.S. section. And he says that there is provable paperwork that the SEC was told by another government agency to stand down on this Stanford affair. And he's going to get to the bottom of it. He's the head of that committee that's handling it. And this is the same thing that happened with Madoff. 13 years, never buying a security. Everybody in Wall Street had to know who had an executive position. He had to have the cooperation of hundreds of people. And he's living in his apartment, albeit a $7 million apartment. How is this? We don't have any protection. And we got two major scandals involving the SEC. And it just shows you all the things I've been telling you on the radio for years regarding the SEC is true. They work with Wall Street, the big firms. They protect them. Wall Street provides them with well-paying jobs after they leave, the revolving door syndrome. And they specialize in knocking off small brokerage houses and middle-sized brokers and brokerage houses, pursuing, for political reasons, newsletter writers. That's what they're all about. They're a Gestapo, just like the IRS. And also the CFTC, the Commodity Futures Trading Corporation. So I can't answer the question because they don't know on any inside, but we know they're doing something. Because, you know, the people who are selling coins, the mints, they got to be getting the gold from somewhere. And how long do you think that's going to persist? Them being able to access bullion. to get blanks to be able to cut coins. They're going to be running out one of these days, probably quickly. So the latter part of this question, especially on how Goldman Sachs is allowing upward price movements in conjunction with option expiry dates and the creation of value traps. Well, I'll make it very simple. In the month of December, I bought, this is hypothetical, mind you, let's say I bought an option to purchase gold at 880, 890,